Thin Lizzy spent years fine-tuning their sound before becoming one of the most recognised rock bands of the mid-70s. What started out as a bluesy folk rock project influenced by Celtic culture and frontman Phil Lynott's Irish upbringing took a 180 somewhere around 1975. In 1976, Thin Lizzy found themselves at the forefront of a burgeoning hard rock scene with one of the year's biggest hits. Today, we're talking all about the classic rock anthem, The Boys Are Back in Town.
There, we just fell about the place. If that chick don't wanna know, forget her. The boys are back in town. The boys are back in town. I said,
hello there, it's Warren Hewitt here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. Welcome back to another episode of Songs That Change Music. If you haven't already, please subscribe, and if you hit the notification bell, you'll be notified when we have a new video. And of course, if you're into production, you can go to producelikeapro.com and sign up for the email list and get a whole bunch of free goodies. Irish hard rockers Thin Lizzy formed in Dublin in 1969. Drummer Brian Downey and bassist lead vocalist Phil Lynott met while still in school, long before they ever dreamed of becoming legendary rock icons. As the group's de facto leader, Lynott wrote most of the band's material over the course of 12 studio albums between 1971 and 1983. Thin Lizzy's first projects were rooted in blues and Celtic folk, with little indication of the heavier rock sound they would infuse later on. The band performed their first gig at a school hall near Dublin Airport in February of 1970. By the end of the year, they'd signed to Decca Records and gone to London to record their self-titled debut album. The album was only a modest seller and failed to chart in the UK. Unfortunately, this trend continued over the course of their first four albums, even with a successful single in 1972. Whiskey in the Jar was Thin Lizzy's take on a traditional Irish ballad, which Decca released against the band's will. Despite this, it reached number one in Ireland and number six overall on the UK charts. When founding guitarist Eric Bell left the band in 1973, he was replaced by two new members, Brian Robertson and 18-year-old Scottish guitarist Scott Gorham, a Californian. Gorman had already relocated to England with his brother-in-law and super tramp drummer Bob Seibenberg, where he played pub gigs in London before auditioning for Thin Lizzy in 1974. He got the gig and the pair of new guitarists helped introduce a whole new sound. Thin Lizzy finally had a charting album with their fifth project called Fighting in 1975. It reached number 60 in the UK, though the band continuously struggled to find any sort of commercial success. Still, however, they did well on the road, touring the US for the first time as support for Bob Seger and Barkman Turner Overdrive. In 1976, Thin Lizzy recorded Jailbreak, which proved to be the breakthrough they had been hoping for. The Boys Are Back in Town was a worldwide hit and helped fully define the band's hard rock twin guitar sound. Shortly after the album's release, Thin Lizzy toured the US again with Aerosmith, Rush, and REO Speedwagon. This helped solidify their status in the brand new market they'd just broken into. The Boys Are Back in Town is easily one of the greatest hard rock hits of all time. Apart from its immediate commercial success and what it did for the band, the song would forge Thin Lizzy's legacy as a progenitor of heavy metal. With bands like Metallica, Alice in Chains, Mastodon, and Testament all citing Thin Lizzy as the primary influence.
Warming long till the summer comes. Now the boys are giving up. The boys are back in town. Yeah. The boys are back in town. The boys are back in town. Spread the word around. The boys are back in town.
The Boys Are Back in Town was composed at a studio in Buckinghamshire in late 1975, during writing sessions for Jailbreak. After the band's previous two albums failed to generate any significant sales, their then label, Vertigo Records, gave them one last chance to prove their worth. The song wasn't written as a hit, per se. In fact, it almost didn't even make the album. Guitarist Scott Gorham recalled, playing in some club in the US when our manager came in and said, "Well, looks like we've got a hit." We were like, "Which song?" Seriously, we didn't have any idea at all which song it was that had taken off for us. To tell you the truth, we weren't initially going to put The Boys Are Back in Town on the Jailbreak album at all. Back then, you picked 10 songs and went with those because of the time restrictions of vinyl. We recorded 15 songs, and of the 10 we picked, that wasn't one of them. But then the management heard it and said, "No, there's something really good about this song." Lynott wrote the lyrics from the point of view of the band and the listeners being in a gang together, which no doubt helped it resonate with such a wide audience. People from Manchester associate the lyrics with the Quality Street Gang, a criminal group not unlike the Mafia. Lynott spent much of his time in Manchester growing up, where his mother ran a nightclub that the gang frequented. From an instrumental standpoint, The Boys Are Back in Town prominently features Brian Robertson and Scott Gorham's dual guitar harmonies that the band first adopted in 1974. Thin Lizzy would become famous for that, with other bands of the era taking notes and further refining the sound.
Hi everyone, Jamie Humphries here again, and Warren has asked me to take a moment to talk a little bit about the iconic melody, harmony melody line that you can hear in The Boys Are Back in Town by Thin Lizzy. Now, there were obviously some iconic guitar players that are performed in Thin Lizzy when Phil Lynott was still alive. Obviously, we had Gary Moore and John Sykes, two huge heavyweights in the world of guitar. But we also have Midgeur, we have Snowy White, and we had Eric Bell, the original guitar player. But possibly the best love guitar duo for Thin Lizzy has to be Scott Gorham and Brian Robertson. Now, there's obviously been many fantastic bands throughout rock history that have utilized twin guitars, from Wishbone Ash, Iron Maiden, Metallica. We could go on and on, and there's going to be bands that I haven't listed that you're all going to be crying out for in the comments section. But for me, it kind of starts with Thin Lizzy. I think that they kind of set the benchmark when it came to arranging and producing incredible dual guitar parts and harmony parts. What we're going to do is we're going to be looking at the main melodic theme. Now, the guitars were recorded a semitone lower, so I've dropped my guitar down by a half step, and obviously it was a Marshall and Les Paul combination. So today I'm using my Gibson Les Paul Modern, and I'm still plugged into my Mesa Badlander, which does a pretty good British impersonation, and I'm running out of the back of that using the onboard cab clone IR with a 4x12 Mesa IR. Now, that iconic guitar harmony part that really drives the song and that you really identify to this song with, I always thought that was just a twin guitar harmony. How wrong I was. It's at least three guitar parts. It could even be more. Some of the parts could be doubled. So the three parts that we have the lower harmony, which is this. So then we have the next part of the harmony, and this is actually double tracked. I can hear one example of this in the middle of the stereo field and another example of this pushed over to the right. Let's have a look at the part that you hear in the middle of the stereo field. I'll play it through for you. We We then have that same part, which is double, but it has a slightly different ending to it, which is just tucked away in the right side of the stereo fill. So let's have a listen to that harmony part now. Now, at the end of the song, we hear this part just grow and grow and grow, and we have several different harmonies layered up. In fact, I've counted at least six. Now, once again, this is open to debate whether or not, you know, some of the parts have been double tracked. And again, it's really difficult for me to tell without sitting down in front of the desk. Now, we obviously have those two melody lines, the two main harmony parts that we heard running throughout. So we have this part. We have this part. Now, those two parts just run throughout, and then gradually we hear other harmonies being introduced. We have this one. We have this one. Then we have this one. So now we have the final harmony. So to wind things up, I'm going to now play you out with all six parts of that harmony of my interpretation and what I think is going on the original recording. So I hope you guys have enjoyed checking out this iconic melody section of The Boys Are Back in Town.
Thin Lizzy convened at the Who's Ramport Studios in South London to record Jailbreak. The band chose John Alcock as their producer due to the fact he'd worked extensively in that studio. The band diligently recorded the album through February 1976. In retrospect, both Thin Lizzy guitarists felt that the project was rushed and not as good as it could have been. They looked back on the album as feeling a bit rigid overall, and Robertson would have enjoyed more freedom to improvise his guitar solos. Gorham has gone so far as to criticise Alcock's production. He wasn't satisfied with the guitar tones on The Boys Are Back in Town or on the album as a whole. Luckily, this was of no consequence to either the album or the single. The single became Thin Lizzy's major commercial breakthrough. Been hanging down at the most. The Boys Are Back in Town released as a single in April 1976, roughly 1 month after the album, reached number 8 in the UK and number 12 in the US, Thin Lizzy's first charting single in America. In their home country of Ireland, the single was a number 1 hit. NME also awarded the song the title of Best Single in 1976. Jailbreak proved to be equally popular as a complete album, hitting number 10 in the UK and 18 in the US. But not until after the traction of its lead single. In fact, Jailbreak was hardly doing any significant numbers at all. That was until a pair of DJs in Louisville, Kentucky got a hold of the song, according to Scott Gorham. We owe it all to two DJs in Louisville, Kentucky. They fell in love with the song and played it incessantly until other stations in the surrounding area picked up on it. Had that song not kick-started the sales of the album, then the band was over. Thin Lizzy will go down as one of the greatest hard rock bands of the 1970s, alongside just a handful of other groups at the time. Thin Lizzy was musically and visually paving the way for thousands of artists, including those in the emerging new wave of British heavy metal. Dual guitar harmonies were the epitome of heavier music of the era. Paired with the black leather and studs, Thin Lizzy evolved from an unassuming folk group to one of the most influential hard rock bands of all time. Individually, Phil Lynott was a significant figure himself. He became the first black Irishman to ever achieve commercial success in rock, at a time when music seemed almost segregated. A few years ago on The Late Late Show, Phil Lynott's daughters, Sarah and Kathleen, said what irked their father more than anything else was people mispronouncing his name. Fans, journalists, broadcasters, nearly anyone saying it aloud frequently mistook it for Lynott instead of Lynott. In public, he wouldn't hesitate to correct someone and quip back to them, "I'm not some bird." The Boys Are Back in Town is a flawless representation of everything that made Thin Lizzy a powerhouse quartet. Leader Phil Lynott's chugging bass and raspy storytelling vocals, guitarist Brian Robertson and Scott Gorham's brawny riffing and signature harmonizing, and of course, Brian Downey's thundering drums holding down the dynamic trio up front. Thin Lizzy, one of the most melodic, heavy rock bands of the 70s that still live on to this day. Thank you ever so much for watching this. If you haven't already, please subscribe, check out the other videos in this series, and have a marvelous time. Thanks ever so much. So long, farewell, auf Wiedersehen, au revoir, tschüss, adios, adio, goodbye.